Welcome this afternoon. My name is Mike Rogge. I'm the local food small pharmacist educator for U of I Extension located in Western Illinois. I work out of the Quincy office. My wife and I also own a fruit and vegetable farm, and we've grown asparagus for, I think, 17, 18 years now. We have a couple acres of asparagus we raise, and because of that, I decided I'd like to make this my topic for our webinar this year. So hopefully we'll provide some good education and get you on your way to a very productive asparagus season. If you do have questions that you have as we go through here, the chat box is located in the lower right-hand corner of your screen. If you have questions, just please type them in there as we go through the program. I'll try to pay attention and look at that chat box with occasion to try and answer questions. Again, if you have questions, just type them into the chat box, lower left-hand corner. Now, generally speaking, asparagus is a long-lived perennial, so it makes sure that you do know where you want to plant it because it will have a long life. Like I said, we planted our first asparagus 17 or 18 years ago. We're still harvesting it. Now, granted, some of the production's declined somewhat, but it should maintain at least 15 years of productivity, if not more. And basically what kills asparagus for the most part, or what causes yields to decline, is root diseases. So as long as we maintain a healthy plant and try to keep root diseases to a minimum, I should expect 15, 20 plus years of life of picking out of an asparagus patch. It is relatively free of diseases. There are a few that we'll discuss here. And about only one insect problem to speak of. And again, that will be covered a little bit later here in our discussion. Because it is a perennial, and its roots are so extensive, the root system on asparagus, by the way, when we built our house in 2001, we killed out about half acre of asparagus to build that house. And as they were digging our basement, they were finding roots of asparagus down 8-9 feet in the ground. This is a very extensive root system, allows it to survive during periods of dry, stressful weather. And because it has such a deep root system, you want to make sure you're planting on a soil that allows that root system to develop to its fullest. So if you have areas of the garden, for instance, where you may have an old area that was in buildings or whatever and has a poor rooting system, or you're in a clay pan soil where you cannot get roots established very deeply, the plant probably won't thrive in those sort of conditions. So you want to try to plant it in a soil that has a very deep root system. Again, when we dug our garden, there were roots of that asparagus down 8 or 9 feet deep in the soil. And for that reason, because it is such a long-lived perennial, you want to try the best you can to reduce any or eliminate any perennial weeds from the area your asparagus will be planted into, just simply because you're not going to have an opportunity to renew this every year since it is a perennial. So make sure you take care of any perennial weed problems before you do plant that crop there. And it's also a good idea to take a soil test and get your soil adjusted if necessary prior to planting that crop, because you're not going to be able to incorporate any fertility to a great depth once that asparagus has been established in that field. Soil test characteristics. Asparagus likes a pH, a fairly high pH for most crops, of 6.7 to 7.0. Remember that on your pH scale, 7 is neutral. Numbers below that indicate acidity. Numbers above that, alkalinity. Most of your garden crops enjoy a pH between 6.2 and 6.5. We like to have a little higher pH for asparagus, so get your pH up to 6.7, close to 7, which is neutral. Asparagus loves high phosphorus testing soils. Our recommendation is to get your phosphorus P1 test up to 250 pounds per acre. This is very, very high, much higher than the rest of your garden is probably going to be. Our normal range for vegetable crops is a pH range of, or excuse me, a phosphorus range of 30 to 40 pounds per acre. So we can see here a 250 pound per acre phosphorus test is very high. So mend your soil with plenty of phosphorus before you plant that asparagus just to get the phosphorus levels up. Potassium levels K2O, 300 pounds per acre, which is our recommendation for most vegetable crops. And we always like to add a little bit of nitrogen at planting time, perhaps 70 pounds per acre of nitrogen at planting time. You can be planting one-year-old crowns when you do plant your asparagus. You can order seeds if you wish. Now, that's a long, lengthy process. What most people have found, and what probably 99% of gardeners grow, is they'll order one-year-old crowns rather than seed. A number of different locations to purchase crowns. Shouldn't be too much of a problem finding them. We'll talk about varieties here in a short time. Soil temperatures, you want to hold off planting asparagus, crowns, until you get 50 degrees soil temperature or better. You want them to be growing actively once you place them in the ground. If you do get your crowns before the soil is ready, you can hold them in a cooler, for instance, at temperatures just above freezing. But what we always do for any of our planting materials, strawberries, asparagus, brambles, whatever, when I order from the nursery, I'll indicate that I'll call them and let them know when they can ship that plant or those crowns. It's so much easier to have them hold on to that crown, because in their cooler they can maintain the temperatures that are optimal for holding those crops much better than what I can hold them in my refrigerator or my cooler, so whatever. So what I'll do is I'll look at the calendar, look at soil conditions, and look at the weather forecast. If I see, for instance, today's Monday, Monday the middle of April, say it's 15th of April on a Monday. I'm not sure if that's a date or not, but let's just play along with this. April 15th, a Monday. Soil conditions are looking pretty good. It's still a little bit too wet to plant yet. The weatherman is telling me, though, that no precipitation is forecast during the latter part of that week. Should be nice temperatures. Soil should be ready based upon my experience and the lack of weather precipitation arriving. So I'll call that nursery and let them know that I'd like to have my asparagus crown shipped so that they're available at my doorstep on Thursday or Friday, because again, the weatherman indicated there's very little chance of rain, and by Saturday when I want to plant those crowns, the soil should be in good working condition. So I always like to have the nursery hold those crops until I'm ready to plant them, because they can hold them much better than I can. As you get your crowns, some growers will separate them into sizes because you will get a range of size of crown from large to small. If you sort them according to size, you can plant similar ones next to each other in a row. That way there won't be any difficulties as far as emergence differences between the crowns. If all the crowns emerge at a similar time, there'd be very little competition between themselves. If we have a very large crown planted next to a very small crown, that large crown is going to emerge first and grow quicker, and it could outcompete to some degree that smaller crown. So if you have the time, separate those crowns into sizes. And lastly, we talked about the need of phosphorus for the crop. Again, phosphorus is, asparagus loves high phosphorus soils. So what we've done in the past is when we dig our trench to plant our asparagus, we'll take bucketfuls of diammonium phosphate, or DAP, which is 46% phosphorus, and we'll spread them in the furrow after we place the crowns in the furrow, just to give that plant a little bit extra kick of phosphorus as it begins to grow. Our rows we place 5 foot apart. You have to remember that these plants will reach a height of 5-6 feet or more in size. And also the plant radius will increase as well. We plant one crown every 12 to 18 inches in the soil in 5 foot rows. But remember that single crown will have spears that emerge, and over time the area that those spears emerge from grows larger. So by the probably the 10th to 12th year, you'll have spears emerging in a 2 foot wide area within that 5 foot row. So make sure your rows have some distance to them. If they're too crowded together, you're not going to have a good walking path between your rows to be able to pick. We plant, we'll have to see plant space within the row anywhere from 12 to 18 inches apart. The closer you place those crowns, the higher yield you'll have early in the production of that field. Eventually, though, there won't be any difference at all as far as yield, simply because, like we talked about, the diameter of those crowns emerging from the soil will eventually spread and they'll intersect with one another. So if you use an 18-inch spacing and a 5-foot row width, you'll be using 5,800 crowns per acre. And you'll see there, if you're narrowing it down to 12 inches, you'll have a little higher crown count per acre. If you want to orientate the crown so that the buds are faced up, they will emerge quicker. If you're planting a couple acres, it's probably not going to be worth your time to do that, though. We just walk through the row, and every 18 inches or so, we're going to throw in a crown. And we'll discuss that here fairly shortly. When you're planting, we just use a moldboard plow and create a furrow with that moldboard plow. You can use a middle buster plow or a potato plow if you like, either, just as long as you can get that soil thrown over out of that row. You'll be able to plant those crowns about 5 inches deep on a clay, silty clay loam soil. Or if you're in sandy soil, a little lighter soil, you probably want to take those crowns down about another inch or so to about 6 inches in depth. Some of your garden catalogs talk about burying asparagus down, 8, 10, 12 inches. Don't follow that advice. It's really too deep. 5 to 6 inches has been the depth that, based upon research, has been the most favorable for asparagus yields. And as we place those crowns and getting ready to cover them up, we just use a blade on the back of the tractor to move that soil that was displaced with the moldboard plow over back into the row to cover those plants. And because that soil is very, very loose, when you're placing it back over the trench, a couple rounds will need to occur before that soil is settled into that trench. And you probably have to go back over and blade that loose soil back over into that row twice, maybe three times during the course of the year. Because again, that looser soil is going to be compacted by the rainfall that occurs to help settle that down in that trench. So plan on taking two or three trips through the field with a blade on the back of your tractor. Here we are a couple years ago. We planted another half an acre of asparagus. And again, we just use a moldboard plow to plow a 5-inch deep furrow in the field. And you can see that in the bottom picture. The top picture, in the row, then we'll place a crown about every 18 inches. And again, we don't take a measuring tape or anything. We're not too precise on that. But the boy's foot here is about 12 inches in length. So a couple inches on either side of that, and we've got our 18-inch planting figured out. So again, not rocket science here. We're pretty simple, but it seems to work pretty well for us. Varieties of asparagus. The last 20 years or so, maybe 30 years, there have been hybrids available that are, of course, we used to plant the old Mary Washington variety. It's an open pollinated variety that has male and female. And those female do produce seeds. and those seeds, if they are allowed to germinate and sprout within the field, become weeds simply because there's just too much asparagus in a given amount of space and there's too much competition there. So Mary Washington is not really a recommended variety at this point in time. It hasn't been recommended for a couple of decades now simply because of the weed seed problems and the increased competition we can get through that. So we like to use the hybrids that provide a lot better yield than the old open pollinated Mary Washington variety. In fact, based upon research, we're seeing 2 to 3 times more yield out of the male hybrids as opposed to the old Mary Washington. So it's well worth your while to investigate these hybrids and utilize them in your planting. The Jersey hybrids have become very popular about, again, 20, 25 years ago. And there's a number of them available. Jersey Supreme, Jersey Knight, Jersey Giant, and there's a few others as well. I'll come out of New Jersey breeding program. Guelph Millennium is a Canadian hybrid. It comes out of Guelph, Ontario, out of the University of Guelph. We have the California hybrids as well. The California hybrids are both male and female plants. They're not all male like the Jersey and the Canadian plants are, but they're both male and female, like the old Martha Washington. And there are some of these varieties that have done very well. Others you probably want to stay away from. Varieties such as UC-157, Atlas, Apollo, Grande, and others. And we'll show you some of the yield trial results of all these varieties here fairly shortly. Carl Cantaloupe is an extension educator in North Carolina's Bay. 25 years ago, he was in Illinois, and he basically started the asparagus movement. You could call it that, I guess. Was growing asparagus. He started about 25 years ago when he was the extension advisor up in Rock Island County. He started some plots up there for asparagus variety trials, and we've used Carl for a number of years for his expertise on asparagus. And actually, between Illinois and North Carolina, he spent some time in Ohio at the Python Research Center, and we're again doing asparagus research. But his comments here on the California hybrids, I think, are well worth being brought out. Now, the California hybrids, again, we talked about which ones they were. The Apollo and Grande probably, and Atlas are the ones you probably want to consider, but these California hybrids at higher temperatures, at temperatures above 70 degrees Fahrenheit, don't fern out quite as easily, or the tips of them don't open up as easily as what the New Jersey or the Canadian hybrids do. And the reason that's important at warmer temperatures is that if we keep that fern from increasing in size, or that plant from heading out, we can keep the spear height a little bit taller, and we don't have as tough as spears either, because once that plant begins to fern out, we have spear toughness occurring. So you always want to pick those when you're harvesting asparagus. You never want the plants to start increasing the head size, because that just indicates a toughening of those spears. You want to keep the spears nice and keep them nice and tender. I see a question down here. Someone says, I have just one plant in the garden which makes seeds. Is it best to remove it? Yes, it is. The seeds, I'm assuming. Because again, those are just going to create weeds for from increased competition. A question: every year my 50 plants perform differently with their seed forming. Do they actually change from male to female by year? No, they don't. The interesting thing though, in these male hybrids, they will produce seeds, or they'll have a seed pod on them, but those seed pods will not really produce seeds. So you still see the red seed pods on these male hybrids, and these male hybrids do produce male flowers. I think I'm pronouncing this right, hermaphroditic in nature, and that's how they got the hybrids in the first place. They found some genetic malfunctioning of asparagus, so to speak, and that's how what they developed to make these male hybrids possible. So you'll see some flowers on the male plant on the male plants, but they will not be fertile flowers. This is just a table of some of the work showing Carl's work on since 2007 in North Carolina, in his research studies looking at a number of different hybrids. On the x-axis, on the top there, shows the years from 2007 to 2013. The y-axis on the side there, going from, goes by the different varieties. And the numbers from 1 through 11 show the rank by year of that particular variety. So if we look at 2007, for instance, the highest yielding variety was UC-157. The second highest yielding was Jersey Giant. You can continue down that line looking at the different varieties. 2007 was the first year of production. And remember, the first 2, 3, 4 years of production are the least amount of picking that you'll get, the lesser yields. So keep that in mind when you look at these results. You want to see higher yields the last 3 or 4 years, and allow that to help determine what variety you'd like to pick. Another question I see here, I think an earlier question was for a suggestion for an organic fertilizer for asparagus. It won't matter as far as what fertilizer you use, just try to make sure that, or do make sure that when you're applying those organic fertilizers, you're applying the correct amounts. We talked about 70 pounds of nitrogen per acre. So choose the nitrogen, an organic nitrogen source that'll provide 70 pounds per acre of nitrogen. If you're trying to increase your soil phosphate rate, your phosphorus level up to 250, about the only phosphorus I know of that's organic in nature is rock phosphate. And rock phosphate can take 20 years or more before the full effects of that phosphate is seen in the soil. So it's going to take some time to build those phosphorus levels up. So if you're an organic gardener, I would suggest that you concentrate on trying to build those phosphorus levels up to a fairly high level before you seed your asparagus. Just do the soil test, look at that, and see what your phosphorus, potassium, and nitrogen needs are, as well as pH. And make those corrections before you plant a lot of that crop, because again, there's not a great deal of phosphorus fertilizer sources for the organic gardener. Anyhow, getting back to the slide here, look for the higher numbers the last couple, 3 or 4 years, and select those hybrids that provide that. And you can see Grande, which is about two-thirds of the way down this list. It's one of the California varieties. In the last 4 years, it's ranked third, first, and third in total production, which is an indication of fairly decent yield. And Jersey Supreme, which is the fourth one down, has looked fairly good as well. Again, these are from New Jersey. I don't think that it would differ too much for our location in Illinois, although, North Carolina, not New Jersey. Carl Campbell is located in North Carolina where these research trials were conducted. They probably have a little sandier soil than what we do, so they probably have a fairly loose soil, which may have some impact on yields as well, but there are no asparagus yield trials that I know of anywhere else in the U.S. as good as Carl's, so that's what I'm showing here. Now, growth habits of asparagus, again, they're perennials, but they have multiple spears that will emerge throughout the year. The spears originate from buds on the crown, and the first buds that will emerge are always the largest and most vigorous. So, and as we go through the year picking, you'll notice that your spear diameter is always smaller towards the end versus the early part of the season, simply because of the bud size and the amount of carbohydrate food supply that root system has. Because all the growth we're seeing on asparagus, as we pick it, originates from stored food reserves in the root system. So as it exhausts that food supply, the spears conversely get a little bit thinner. Okay, the question is, what kind of fertilizer needs do you need for an established bed that, say, is 20 plus years old? Again, you want to make sure you have nitrogen, about 70 pounds per acre. And then look at your soil test. Hopefully you've taken soil tests every 3 or 4 years, and you've documented what the phosphorus and potassium levels are. We want to maintain very high phosphorus levels and, you know, a potash level of, say, 300 pounds per acre. So you can be looking at several hundred pounds of diammonium phosphate per year per acre, plus maybe 100 pounds or so of potash, old 60. Per acre per year, but let your soil test indicate what your fertility rate should be. How long can we pick male hybrids? Again, this is for male hybrids, not for the Mary Washingtons. Again, we talked earlier about spear diameter, spear size will continue to decline as the season progresses simply because the plants are running out of energy. So we don't want to exhaust the energy supply from that plant. Otherwise, it's going to take it that much longer to realize fern growth. After you get done picking in the fern growth, the photosynthesis material supplied by the ferns during the summer and stored in the root is what causes spears to emerge in the spring. So we don't want to overdo our picking. It can harm the plant. The rule of thumb is the first year after you plant a male hybrid, you can pick it for 2 weeks. Now, we would not do this if we had Mary Washington. Mary Washington, again, is not quite as vigorous of a plant. We want to wait 2 years after planting before picking Mary Washington. But for the male hybrids, it's safe to pick those plants a year after you plant them. Again, it's a limited pick, maybe 2 weeks at the most. Next year, increase that harvest length to 4 weeks. The next year, 8 weeks. And by the fourth year, you're into full picking. You can get 2 months worth of picking out of these male hybrids. So you get an extra earlier year with the male hybrids as opposed to the Mary Washington open pollinated hybrid, or male, excuse me, the Mary Washington open pollinated varieties of asparagus. Again, these are ballpark. You know, we can say 2 weeks, but if it's 2 weeks of 90 degree weather, we certainly wouldn't want to do that. If it's 2 weeks of 40 degree weather, you won't be picking much either. So the best rule of thumb is to discontinue picking once 3/4 of the spears are less than pencil size diameter. That indicates that the plant is starting to utilize its stored food reserves, and it's best to quit picking at that point in time, let the plant recuperate and begin storing energy for next year's crop. These are estimated yields of some of your male hybrids. You can read them there. Again, fairly decent yields, very good yields for male hybrids. So you can get a return back on your investment the year after your plant for male hybrids. And again, expect 10 to 15 years of really good production. In fact, you'll probably get your peak production around year 8 to 10. And that should hold for, you know, 5 or 6 years. And you're probably going to start to see a little decline in production simply because the effect of the age on the stand, as well as individual plants and root diseases and so forth. But at least 10 to 15 years of fairly decent production. Again, we're picking our first planting and it's 17 or 18 years old. We've noticed a slight decline, but we're not ready to tear it up yet. Although we did plant another 0.6 acre here just a couple of years ago, knowing they'll be kind of recycling some of this older production out of production into something else. So do you snap it off or do you cut it? And go to the store and purchase asparagus, and you'll note the bottom 4 or 5 inches is wood and that you have to throw away. It's non-edible. And I think the reason's obvious why they do that. They sell by the pound. So if you can sell more pounds, you're going to get more income. But you have to remember that homeowners who purchase asparagus from the store end up tossing a third of it away. So we snap ours off by hand, as do many other growers in Illinois. When you snap it off by hand, you're always snapping above that woody part because you can't snap the wood. You only snap off that vegetative part that is tender. So snap it off above the woody end, you're getting a product that's 100% edible, but should be valued more at the store or at your sales stand or in the farmer's market because it is 100% edible. You need to make your buyers aware of the fact that it's hand-snapped individually, 100% edible, so it's going to be worth 30% more easily than what the store bought is simply because you have 30% more there to sell to them. If you do decide to cut off the little soil, be cautious. You're going to use a knife to do that. And if there are any other developing spears that are emerging alongside that emerged spear you're cutting off, you risk the possibility of cutting that off as well, and that's your future yield. So be cautious if you're using a knife to cut off the little ground. Harvest management, what we look at is 2 or 3 weeks prior to beginning a harvest, we'll mow off the dead stalks that we've allowed to remain over winter. We don't mow off, we don't burn our stalks in the fall of the year. I like to leave them on. I'll leave them on for a purpose. Oftentimes, especially growers in the northern parts of Illinois, can get a late spring frost on emerged asparagus and lose whatever percent of that crop has emerged at that time. Asparagus will not tolerate temperatures below 30, 31 degrees. It'll frost off the plant, the emerged spears. By leaving those ferns on, we allow enough shade to remain on that soil that the soil doesn't warm up enough and the crowns don't start producing too early so that we avoid any late frosts. So we'll wait. And we always mow off ours here in Southern Illinois Cole and Quincy, about the 1st of April, with our expected first harvest around the 15th to the 20th of April. So we'll wait 2 weeks, maybe 2.5 weeks prior to our first harvest, and then mow that fern off. And then we'll apply a herbicide to keep weeds at bay. And we'll talk about that here in a little bit short time. We try to pick, and you should try to pick, as early in the morning as possible, because that's when the heat of the field is at its lowest. You know, in April and May, you know, let's say the end of April when the high temperature may be 50 degrees, that's not a big deal. But if you're picking in June, for instance, and the high temperature is 90, which sometimes it is, you want to try to avoid that. So you want to try to pick any crop, regardless of asparagus or sweet corn or cucumbers or whatever. Always try to pick during the coolest part of the day when the crop is at its coolest. So that's first thing in the morning. And we try to get that crop to cooler as soon as possible. My question is, we're growing organically here. No herbicide can be used. What's the best way to control weeds for us? And you've got two choices. One would be a good mulch. And you want to apply that mulch between the rows of asparagus to a depth that prevents sunlight from penetrating the soil. If you keep sunlight from penetrating the soil, you'll keep weeds down. And that probably needs an organic mulch, like leaves, for instance, or straw, or grass clippings. Some folks are using newspaper, put about 4 or 5 sheets of newspaper with a couple dirt clods on them, scattered throughout. We'll put those newspapers down with straw on top and then wet them so they'll stick well together. A couple 5-6 sheets of newspaper with 3 or 4 inches of straw, wet it down real well. Will hold up fairly well over the summer. And again, place that between the rows. It's going to be hard to keep weeds out in between the plants other than hand pulling. And you're still going to have to hand pull using newspapers and straw as well. But that's basically your weed control for organic gardening in a perennial crop like asparagus. We use salt to control weeds. We're going to talk about that real shortly. And if you get nothing else from this talk here, the one thing I want you to note is you should never use salt on asparagus because it kills the soil, and we'll talk about that soon. So never use salt on asparagus. And getting back to the slide here, pick early in the morning as possible. Wash the crop off, especially if it rained overnight. You're going to have a splashing raindrop that'll put dirt on the asparagus spear, but wash it off. And when you're washing it, be cautious that the wash water you use is no more than 10 degrees colder than the crop that you're applying it to, regardless of what crop you're washing off. The reason you do that is to avoid fecal contamination or contamination by any other pathogens. So be cautious on temperatures of wash water and temperature of produce you're washing. Asparagus has a very high respiration rate, very high. So it's best to be held at a cooler temperature. And you can store asparagus for some time. If you're going to store asparagus, though, always do it in a dark environment and always store them upright. If you lay them on their side, that asparagus continues to grow. If it's on its side, what you'll see is the fern heads eventually try to curl up and become vertical. So always store those plants or those the asparagus in upright condition. We do it in shallow water in a tub and keep it in a very, very dark location so it discourages growth. Again, we talked about tenderness or toughness is related to spear tightness. The more open the top of that spear is, the more tougher the texture is going to be. So try to get it before it opens up much at all. And that depends upon the temperature of the growing season when you're picking asparagus. At 90 degrees, on some warm days, you may have to pick it twice. It's not uncommon on very, very warm days to see asparagus grow 6 or 8 inches in a matter of 6 or 8 out 10 hours. So you may pick it in the morning and may pick it in the evening at very warm temperatures. 60 degree temperatures, on the other hand, may take, if that's a high for the day and gets down to 40 at night, it may take 2 or 3 days before the spear gets long enough to even pick. So let spear length determine how often you pick, not calendar, but let spare length dictate that. The thing you've got to be cautious about as well is not harvesting the entire patch as you go through if it needs picking. Some of these smaller diameter spears that we don't pick, for instance, because they're too small to pick, will eventually fern out. And when they fern out, they're very attractive sites to the asparagus beetle. And we've got a picture here, we can show you a little later on what the asparagus beetle is, but it's about the only insect you have to worry about that damages asparagus. But it's a very attractive site, it's a ferned out asparagus, to the asparagus beetle. So be cautious of that. This picture you see here is a harvest aid that we use to help pick our asparagus. It's basically just it's a frame from a wagon with a 15 horsepower engine on the back of it with a Jeep gearbox that we purchased from another grower about 15 years ago in Northern Illinois. And it's geared down to allow us to go about, well, you can walk faster when this thing goes. But it allows us to pick three rows at a time. You can see the three chairs there, and we have steering is accomplished by means of the person sitting in the middle, and they steer with their feet. So it helps us alleviate stoop labor, although it is kind of slow, so we don't use it very often. But it can help if you have a lot of asparagus to harvest and your back gets tired. Again, we talked about the need for asparagus to be able to fortify itself and reinvigorate itself by allowing it to photosynthesize through the fern after you get them picking. So do not, whatever you do, do not overpick asparagus. It does need a chance to recover and recuperate, because only when the fern is fully developed will the photosynthesis material will photosynthesize, and then the sugars translocate down the root system, which will allow you then to pick those spears the following year. So don't overdo it. Again, when the majority of the spears get pencil size diameter or smaller, discontinue picking. There are different types of asparagus. You know, we've all seen the green asparagus. Although sometimes under cool growing conditions, you'll get a little purple discoloration of those greens, but nothing like the purple we see pictured here. Well, this variety, Purple Passion is its name. There may be one or two others, but I know Purple Passion is a purple-colored asparagus. It will cook out. It's not going to stay with the plant, with the spear after it cooks. It's just a skin pigmentation. White asparagus, you may have seen that as well. And that's simply green asparagus that's had something dark that's been placed over it to prevent photosynthesis from occurring. So if you're wanting white asparagus, it's going to obviously take a little bit more management to get that. You have to place black plastic or some other sort of container mounted up to allow the asparagus to grow above ground and yet keep all sunlight away from that so it will not photosynthesize. So it should command a higher price. And you might find that at some of your specialty stores or specialty restaurants. Soil fertility. Again, 70 pounds per acre of nitrogen, and we put that on after we harvest as we're renovating. We don't put it on before, but we do it after. And then based upon soil tests, we're trying to maintain a very high phosphorus level. Again, phosphorus levels of 250 pounds per acre and potassium level of 300 pounds. So again, that's going to take several hundred pounds per acre of diammonium phosphate, DAP, which is an 18.46% material per acre, and at least 100 pounds of potash, 0060 is the analysis for that per acre as well. And again, those are put on after harvest. Insect concerns, there's really only one insect we worry about with any great degree, and that's the asparagus beetle. This is a picture in the lower right-hand corner of the beetle itself. Upper right-hand corner, you'll see those little black dots. Those are the eggs that the asparagus beetle will lay on the spear. Now, the beetle itself can cause spear damage because as it feeds on the spear, it etches some of the outer layer of that skin of the asparagus. whenever you get some sort of a damage to the outside of the asparagus, whether it be asparagus beetle or hail, for instance, or blowing sand, that causes a nick or a break or an abrasion on the side of the asparagus, it always causes the asparagus to grow unevenly. The asparagus will kink over towards that wounded area because that wounded area quits growing, whereas the rest of it continues to grow, so it'll always shepherd's crook over. So that kind of causes a loss of quality on your asparagus. So we'll spray for the asparagus beetle. We do that 3 years out of five. We don't do it every year. Depends upon how serious the beetle is and how much damage it's causing us. And 7 XLR is a very good control, unless you're organic. Organically, I suggest that if you see the spears with the black specks on them, you can be assured that the asparagus beetle is present. The asparagus beetle itself, if you walk up to an asparagus, it can hear you or see you or sense you. It'll drop to the ground. So they're sometimes hard to find, but if you find them, as we're picking, we just put them between our thumb and finger, and they don't last too long doing that. Question is, since I must leave 25% of spears, don't I always leave egg-laying sites? I don't know why you'd want to leave 25% of your spears. Maybe you're alluding to the fact that I said quit picking when 75% of the spears are pencil size in diameter. That's for the entire patch. You want to pick your patch entirely, but when you see the majority of your spears be pencil size, diameter, or smaller, you quit picking the entire patch. So pick the entire patch if you can. The smaller spears, either discard or put them into freeze them or do something with them. Actually, we eat the small spears ourselves if we're not too full. Of course, we've got 2 acres to pick, so it doesn't take long to get full of raw asparagus, but nothing else will eat them, other than letting the bugs have them, I figured. Other insects that sometimes cause injury, like black cutworms, they're rare when they do cause problems. You can see a picture of one extra corn plant in the lower right-hand corner. You get the same injury you can get with black cutworms, you can get with hail, asparagus beetle, anything that chews on one side or braises one side of that plant is going to cause a crooked stem, as you can see on the left side there. Diseases, the most common disease we see on our asparagus is a fungal disease called Cercospora. That's very easy to identify by that football-shaped lesion on the stem itself. And what can happen if left unchecked, it'll cause a premature dying of the above-ground fern. Now, we've had this, the first year we had this, we weren't sure what we had, so we had all our ferns die out in September. And when that happens again, you don't have the full complement of food resources going down to the root system to allow a good spirit crop the following spring. So you always want to keep as much fern as possible, and you want to die a natural death of cold rather than disease. So we scout for this disease in August and September, and if we have to, we'll spray one of the Mancozeb or Bravo or something like that at intervals to help control it. The reason most asparagus fails is because of fusarium root and crown rot. There are really no controls for fusarium. The best way to avoid it is to keep your plants healthy. Don't over-harvest. Make sure soil fertility conditions are good. Avoid stressing the plant. Using a good soil to plant on, good drainage, etc. Just try to avoid anything that will stress the plant out. But what fusarium does, basically it rots the crown and the root. If you dig the crown root, you can see, like in the lower right-hand corner picture there, not much of that crown is left. And actually, I think the third root over, you notice a hollowing of that root. And the fusarium basically causes a rotting of that crown and that root system. So it's pretty evident when you have it. And you don't want it. One thing to avoid, if at all possible, is planting asparagus back onto asparagus. because this fusarium is a fairly long-lived disease, and again, because it causes a shortening of the stand, playing asparagus back on the asparagus will help prevent some of that loss of life. For weed control, again, do not use salt. Salt sterilizes the soil. The reason asparagus can survive salt when nothing else can is because what I talked about in the first few minutes of our presentation today. When we dug our basement in our house, we had roots that were 8 foot deep. That's how asparagus survives, using salt that would kill anything else. Again, never use salt on asparagus because you'll sterilize that soil. And once you take that asparagus off, nothing else will grow on that site for years and years and years. So never use salt. If you're not organic, you can use certain different products, Diuron, Dactol, Preem, Prowl. There's others that are offered for pre-emerge control of grasses mostly, and some small seeds and broadleaves. They're not going to last the entire season. None of these are going to last the entire season, so reapplication is going to have to occur. The thing to remember on all these products is that they have to be incorporated into the soil. And in my opinion, tilling asparagus leads to fusarium. So we, in our 17 or 18 year asparagus patch, we've never tilled that soil whatsoever because there's so many roots in the top inch of soil that a tiller's pass destroys those roots and invites, in my opinion, fusarium attack. So try not to till if you can. So how do you incorporate herbicides if you're not tilling? We wait for the black clouds to appear to the west of us. And that's what we do. When we see a good chance of rain in the forecast and we know we need to be applying a pre-emerge herbicide, we'll apply it and allow the rainfall to incorporate that product. Post-emerge, I got two products listed here, Post and Select. They're both grass herbicides. Both these herbicides can be used in asparagus after the grass comes up to kill the emerged grasses. They will not kill or not injure the asparagus, so they're very safe for asparagus. If you're looking for additional herbicides, the Midwest Vegetable Production Guide for Commercial Growers lists them. And I give you the website where you can download this publication at no cost. If you're going to till up an asparagus patch, till very shallow. You'll know we've had some very intense rains several springs here the last, well, probably 3 and 4 years ago. We had some very, very heavy rains. And we had some erosion occur on some of our asparagus. I was astounded the number of roots that I saw when a half inch of soil was washed off that field. There were so many roots in the top inch of soil. I would be very cautious about tilling to control weeds in asparagus. question, but what about mulches for keeping weeds down? Yeah, we talked about that earlier. For organic growers and others who want to use mulches, I think it's a great idea. The concern is you're not going to be able to use those mulches very readily after, let me take this back. As the plants, as the spears are emerging, as long as you don't have a very deep mulch, the spears will emerge through that. If you have a 4 or 5 inch mulch of compost or something like that, I'd be cautious about putting those in the row simply because of emergence issues. But yes, use mulches if you can to help provide weed control. Question, why do people pay more for nutritionally inferior white asparagus? I don't know. But some restaurants can sell it to them, so I guess it's a novelty, I suspect, but good question. A few other comments here. Frost, the reason we don't mow our ferns out is simply because we don't allow the, we don't want early spear growth to occur with the frost, so we wait until 2 or 3 before we begin picking before we'll mow everything off. And again, wind or hail, we talked about this earlier. If you get an abrasion on one side of the stem, that part of the plant quits growing and you get a shepherd's crook. Best thing you can do there is as soon as you start to see a crook over, regardless of the size, pick it because it'll never grow straight. A quick budget, we talked about 3,000 pounds or more earlier. Matter of fact, we talked about 4,000 or 5,000 pounds on a mature bed of male asparagus, priced at two and a half per pound. And it's fairly safe to say most of you are probably getting 2.5 per pound. Cost of spears has probably risen a little bit since I wrote this. This is probably a couple of years old. I'm guessing you probably get 1,000 spears for $220 maybe. And you can use 6,000 spears per acre, let's say. So you're talking 6 times 2, $1,200, $1,400 maybe for an acre of Jersey asparagus crowns. If you get 500 pounds the first year after planting, you've almost paid for your entire crown supply that first year. Now you have other costs as well, but again, you're going to have this asparagus plant for at least 15 years of harvest, so you can do the budgeting yourself there. But in my opinion, asparagus is a pretty safe bet economically for most people. Again, this is several years old, uses some lower costs there for asparagus. You can put your own costs there and see what they might be, but anyway, that was my presentation on asparagus. Question, should I pick off the berries? You can if you want to. I'm assuming you're talking about like Mary Washington or one of the California varieties. If you want to, that'll reduce the amount of weeds or germinating seedlings. It's probably a lot easier though to just haul those things out as they appear in your row. Unless you just have one or two plants, otherwise you'll spend all day trying to pick those berries off. There's a lot of them. It's probably not worth your time. Grow the male hybrids and don't worry about picking off the berries. The New Jersey hybrids are very commonly grown in Illinois, and I would recommend one of those for your garden just to avoid the problem of competition from those seedling asparagus. And plus your yield is going to be 2 to 3 times higher than a Mary Washington. Question, is it better to plant Jerseys for early harvest, Californias for warmer weather and continuing harvest? I never thought about that. I don't know that, I'd worry too much about it. The thing is with the Jersey and the Guelph, the Canadian hybrids, they're going to ferment out at a cooler temperature than what the California ones will. The California ones will allow you to turn out into the 70s and so forth and 80s, whereas the New Jersey ones will turn out a little bit sooner. As long as you're timely on your picking, I wouldn't worry too much about it. I don't know that you can actually increase the length of time you're picking if you plant those two varieties, simply because they're going to both mature about the same time. And again, once the majority of the spears are pencil size and diameter are larger, you want to quit picking them anyway. So I don't know if it's going to really do you what you're looking for. It's an interesting concept, trying to increase your picking time by growing both of those, but I don't think that's actually going to do that. Is wild asparagus good to eat? Sure, I grew up on it. My parents still pick asparagus out of the fence row where it used to be. And those plants are, or no, they're probably 50, 60, 70 years old. Yeah, they're not going to yield nearly what the hybrids are going to yield, but they're still fine, you bet. Okay, then, well, thanks for listening. It's 2 o'clock, and we'll sign off for today. Hope everybody has a productive season. Thanks again.